So I'm going to waffle on at you. I apologise because I know it's kind of close to dinner. So I'm sorry. And I've got two projects to talk about today. I'm just going to get these out. With my very dodgy looking drugs, which I'll explain. Mm-hmm. And I'm from, at Credit Continuum, from a blog and all that stuff. And I'm from the Disruptive Media Learning Lab in Coventry University. I know some of you have definitely been there in this room. If you haven't, please come and join us, because we do, basically what we do at the DML is do really exciting things, and our job is to be risky, believe it or not, in higher education. Shock horror. So the first, project I'm going to talk to you about is Escaped, and the framework that we came up for people who want to look at creating these sort of interactive live action games for higher education. So yes, that's just the space at DML. I'm not going to spend too much time on that. We do lots of projects, a lot of EU projects as well, so we're always open to collaborations with other universities and businesses and things like that. But what I want to talk about is our Game Changers project, which looks more at internal university projects. And it's all about looking at game-based learning at the university and how we can support that. And some random words about what we do. But essentially, we're risky. That's what we like to think of when we do this. And just a little bit about me. So I've come from the games design industry. I worked at Codemasters, which is, they do F1, if you've heard of it, the AAA games, so F1, Dirt, Grid, racing games, that sort of stuff, and an indie company from Wales, Dark Rock Games, little games. So, does anyone know where this is? And I'm looking at you, Andy, because if you don't know this, you should be sacked.
It's Hay on Wye.
It is Hay on Wye. Does everyone know what Hay on Wye is? It's basically this amazing place, which is just full of bookshops. Absolutely brimming, just every shop is a bookshop. And why is this important? Well, I'm just going to give you a little bit of my background, because this, for me, so imagine 7-year-old me, this is basically what our family outings were, is we would go to this place, and this is where my fascination with curiosity really started. And this is Hay on Wye, basically. All of the bookshops are these really interesting places where you go down into deep, dark cellars, and it's just full of books. And what I used to love doing was going through this and thinking, oh my God, there is an adventure here. That curious feeling of just going through the books, am I going to find something? Am I going to go into Narnia? It was just amazing. It just, look at this. This inspires just everything about this genre that I love personally. And this is my background. Unfortunately, I grew up. And now I love video games. And actually, you know, from my background, I've come from a traditional games design background in computer games. And when I started at Coventry University, I did a lot of serious games which were just computer-based. And it was kind of a trend. It was really the trend of, okay, we're gonna do, everything is technology-driven, everything is about the technology. How can we do games by technology? Which is fine. It's just, I felt that there was something missing. And also, there was a real disconnect between what I was developing and the actual people that were going to use it, because the facilitators that were going to use this technology, there would be sometimes quite a big development time for computer games. I was the expert because I was developing it, which meant they didn't really have much say, they didn't have no control over the situation. And we dealt a lot with things like perceived benefit of use, accessibility and acceptability as well amongst staff. It was not a good time. But I found in my personal life, what happened was I started to move away from me playing these kind of these computer games. And more, I don't know, Battlestar Galactica, anyone? Yes. Okay, so there's a great board game, Battlestar Galactica, which is just fantastic. It's all about hiding, being sort of, being a bastard, really, which is kind of what you want. But this is kind of what changed. I noticed that actually this was something that was starting to grow. If you look at the games industry at the moment, there is much more of a drive in terms of people actually playing board games. They want to be more social. They want to be around people. So there's actually a real big movement at the moment of people going into this sort of thing. And now these two people pretty much dominated again my childhood. Obviously, Crystal Maze and Nightmare. Anyone comes up with an idea to do a Nightmare educational game, please let me know, because I'm still there. But it's happening in industry. These things are back. They did a rerun of this. There's one in London. And Nightmare, there's a live version of Nightmare now traveling around, which should say something about where we are in games at the moment. And it was really exciting, because when I moved to the DML, I was given free rein to start looking at how we could step away a little bit from the computer and look at how we can actually get more into the sort of interactive games between each other, the live action sort of things. Now I play D&D, and I love that. And I've been looking at various different interactive games. A lot of my friends do live action role play and that sort of stuff. And escape rooms just jumped at me. And I will have to say that I'm fairly new to this sort of area. And I know there's a lot of people in here doing so many more interesting things. But I will show you what we've done anyway, what we did, and what we are doing. So going back to what I said earlier, one of the biggest problems that we had was actually convincing lecturers that games, game-based learning, this sort of thing is relevant in higher education. So the biggest thing that we wanted to start with was actually addressing the fact of, well, do they find it relevant? Because if we can't convince them, then we can't get it actually into HE. Because, you know, everyone sat in this room are adopters already of this sort of stuff. But there are some really stubborn people, I don't know about you, but in my university especially, that don't want to do anything which is going to take up time or energy. So how do you convince those people? So we did a prototype. We ran a prototype of an escape room at a university event, staff training. It was specifically for our engineering and mechanics building. So the educational objective really, to be honest, they didn't realise it was a bit of a test. Ethics. But yes, for them, it was just developing their skills between themselves. But what we did was we had two rooms side by side. We had a Skype connection between the rooms, and we split the puzzles over two rooms. So one room would have some puzzles, second room puzzles, and they would talk between each other. And that was really interesting to watch, actually, because considering these people are meant to be educationalists, considering they're meant to teach people, they were not very good at speaking to each other and telling each other what was actually in the rooms. And that was a really interesting experience for them. The feedback at the end of it was what they really learned was at the end in the reflection process. So that was a big learning curve for us in terms of, well, this is obviously a really important part of developing something like this. So I just have a short video, which we did. We took some video of this prototype and stuck it together. So that was just a little clip of what happened. But basically, what came back and what was really positive about moving forward with this sort of thing was that every one of the lecturers said that they found it fun, engaging, they could see it being used for their own practice, which was the most important thing. Now, we have something called action-led learning at Coventry University, which is what they sort of quoted a lot, which is quite like problem-based learning, basically. But they could see the overlap between them. The questions that arose were things like, how do I do something like this for 400 students? Which is an interesting question. There are obviously ways to do that, but it definitely gave me something to go back and reflect on in terms of, right now, how can we design this for large numbers of students as well as small numbers of students? So, this is the ESCAPE framework. We've got to. Now, I realise, talking to you guys who've already done this stuff, you probably don't need a framework to help you design escape rooms. But this is what we do at the DML. We look at how we can turn things or create things like this to help the lecturers and students create their own thing. And it's really about giving people the expertise rather than people coming to me and saying, I want you to design me a game, which is both time consuming and not the point, because I really want you to go away and be able to become the master yourself, and so that you can just take it and go with it. As you see, it's split into six columns: participants, objectives, theme, puzzles, equipment, and evaluation. Now, I won't go too much into it here because there's a lot more information, and I'm happy to talk about how each one of those breaks down, or if you are so inclined, want to read a paper or anything like that. But did I just pull this out of my ass? No. No, I didn't. It's actually based off previous work that I've developed with one of my colleagues, and Scott Nicholson's paper, Peeking Behind the Locked Door. So it's based on the transdisciplinary model, which, if anyone's done a game design, which I'm sure you're here thinking, yes, I have, you know it's a pain. You know it's really difficult. Now add to that elements of education. You know what, learning objectives. Maybe you want to change behaviors and things like that. Oh, it suddenly begets just so much more complicated. And how do you deal with all of that stuff? And how, I think someone mentioned before, multidisciplinary teams, how do you deal with all of that? So, yes, like I said, on previous work of designing games or serious games in this field, what we developed was the transdisciplinary model, which basically takes elements from four different frameworks. So the four-dimensional framework by De Freitas et al., which looks specifically at games, educational games. The intervention mapping approach, which is basically it's a health intervention mapping approach. So this is looking really about how you change behaviours, because you might not always want to just put learning objectives in there. You actually might want to look more about, okay, well, I want my students maybe to start looking how to do this a little bit more. The mechanics, dynamics, and aesthetics frameworks, which is a pure games design framework. And the learning mechanics and game mechanics model, Arneb, my colleague, is actually looking at, again, education and games, matching the learning mechanics of game mechanics. And what we did was we came up with all of this previously, a few years ago. And the ESCAPED model follows quite closely the transdisciplinary model, but with elements from Scott Nicholson's paper to help inform that more live action process. But actually, the development of serious games and live action games are very, very similar. That's just some of the transdisciplinary model. Again, if people want to actually look at the paper, it's a very big journal paper, so I apologize if you do. But that's kind of the background to it. and how it's sort of theoretically informed as well. And where are we now with Escaped? Well, at the moment, so now we know it works. Lecturer's happy, yay. So we have a few people in Germany developing a game using our framework. We've got a game going on at the university looking at how we can teach students to use Lego Mindstorms, all sort of interesting things. We're gonna hopefully, where's Daryl? Yeah. We're writing a journal paper at the moment, which is gonna be great, yes. So we also created how-to videos for people who maybe don't wanna watch or read through all the papers. You're more than welcome to watch them at any point. It's always on the Game Changers website. But they're basically small 2-minute videos which basically breaks down the framework and easy to read. And those are the research papers that are already out there. So if you are that way inclined, then they're there to show you actually a little bit more in depth the Escape framework itself and what's happening with it. And the end bit really is that my job really now is to validate the framework. So if anyone does decide to use the framework, which I'd be grateful, I'd love to collaborate and basically look at how we evaluate it properly. And that's sort of where I am with that project itself. And I know it's dinner time, so I'm gonna try and be really quick with Bewildered. This follows on from Escaped and my obsession now with curiosity and how we can utilize this, because actually what I realized was with escape rooms, what it really boils down to in game mechanics terms is the mystery, the narrative, the theatrical side of it, and the puzzles. And this is what makes it really, really engaging. Now, Bewildered is slightly different, but in a really similar space in games design. Has anyone heard of the Mystery Package Company?
Yeah,
it's my favorite thing ever. It's the most awesome thing. I'm totally obsessed. And if anyone hasn't heard of it, there was a video, but I'm not gonna do it because I don't have time. But basically, what you do is you sign up to a website, and you order an experience for someone that I'm going to say you love, maybe you hate them. Because basically what happens is that in about a month's time, a crate gets delivered to this person's house. And I bought one for my partner, and it turned up a month later, wooden crate, nailed shut, with a letter addressed to him. And just watching his face was priceless, to be honest, because when he opened it and there's a wooden crate staring at you, and you have no idea where it's from, you think, what the hell is this? Do I want to really open this? I'm not sure I do. But you have to prise open the thing, and it's a real theatrical performance of getting in there and sort of, and it's really haptic, it's just amazing. And basically there's a story contained in there. But as you go through it, you realize actually there's puzzles embedded in there. So it's very emotional. I think that if you're quite inclined to good narratives and things like that, then it will draw you in. And the one I ordered was a horror experience, which led to some interesting discussions at the end of it. But yes, basically I got really obsessed and I thought, well, how can we use this? Because this is kind of following on from the escape rooms in a way. It's just, and what we've seen today, the sort of boxes. But it's more focused on the narrative and less about the time taken to do something. It's a very personal journey through the stuff. So we did a prototype. And it was for our MSc Strength and Conditioning course in a module titled Client Profiling and Needs Analysis. Now, these were for master students who, by the professor's words, are very masculine. People, I don't know how to best to describe that, but imagine the sporty of sportiest people, and then imagine them trying to do something really creative and narrative based. And this is the kind of thing that we had going on here. And basically, what we did, and what I wanted to do, was, well, kind of just shock the hell out of them almost. Not shock, but play with ethics and play with this whole idea of let's take some risk here. And luckily enough, the professor just doesn't care at all. And I was so lucky to have him to do this this prototype, because he was quite happy with just saying, right, we're going to just experiment here. We're going to shake things up and really sort of see where we go from here. So the course was run over a set number of weeks. And basically, this is what we did. So we designed several packets. This is just one of them, to go to the students each week, addressed to the professor, but actually it was for them. We set up the experiment as if it was from a real company. So they were asked to sign a non-disclosure agreement at the beginning. They were told that they would be part of their assessment would be to give a presentation to this fake company. And it was all about them coming up with a needs assessment for a fake athlete who they believed was real. And these, basically, and again, I don't really have time, but this was followed up by some taught sessions and two practical sessions to get students aware of how to actually conduct a needs analysis and kind of position them academically to deal with what was coming. So week four, we started posting packages. And the packages contained interesting bits of data and props and various things. So one of the packages contained this, lovely drugs. This, now you can actually take this, it's a mixture of dextrose and various other nutritional supplements, which was created by the professor. He is licensed to do this, and it was all measured out properly. And actually what we found was the students took it, which was an interesting thing. And we will remember in the future, and it's really good that it was all measured out. But basically, some of them actually reported having heightened ability, should we say. So there's actually a placebo effect going on, which is amazing. But they believed that this was from a company called NitroTrain, and that this was the nutritional supplement that had been prescribed for the athlete that they were meant to do the needs analysis for. They were sent things like these saliva samples, which is actually real saliva, so the students could analyse this. So the props were all functional.
They didn't take that, did they?
Well, I hope not. I don't know, but I hope not. But they did analyse them. So actually the data within these samples was used as part of their learning process, but you can see how the props become functional. And various bits, like there's a flyer for NitroTrain and letters from the fake company to say, here's the data, here's the stuff. So it was all theatrical. And it came from different sources. And there was a USB with videos of the athlete fighting and losing a fight. And what we tried to sneak in there was underlying psychological problems with the athlete. So some of these came from the company that wanted the needs analysis. Some came from the NitroTrain people, and some looked like it was coming from the athlete himself, basically as a cry for help, which I think was what we wanted to do, is see if they picked up on these things. Unfortunately, we needed to be a little bit more bludgeoning with it, I think, because they didn't get that, but it was all about the ethics involved. And then we did a focus group at the end to see what they thought of it. And what really came out was four main things. So the students talked mostly about the approach itself, the organisation of the learning experience, the relevance of the learning experience to future employment, and development of new skills. And this is just some of the quotes from the students in the focus group, which are quite interesting. I just think it was a good little extra thought to put in process. I think it made the coursework look a bit more interesting. When you see the patches, everyone was sort of like, what on earth is this? And then you open it and like, what is going on? So it was an interesting element to the coursework. I think it looked at our analysis skills, our ability to do it together, research and critique the research, and compare that with the real data in the athlete. For me, those were the main bits. I'm happy to share the journal that I've just done with this, but there's some really, really interesting things in there about my main point, which I promise I will be very quick with now, is basically what it flagged up was they found that they were really confused about receiving these packages. They didn't know how to deal with this. And I'm sure you may have seen something similar in escape rooms as well, because I've seen it when I've done escape rooms in the university setting as well, is that people sometimes have no idea what's going on. And this confusion and anxiety is something that really unnerves people. It's the uncertainty of not knowing what the hell you do. And what we found was that the students who exhibited high levels of uncertainty come from a very structured background in terms of they've been to another university which was very like, this is what we're doing, this is the assessment, you must do this, you must do that, you must do that. And they wanted to be told exactly that. Whereas we deliberately put them out of place and said, no, when you get the packages, you can do what the hell you want. Your assessment is at 20 minutes at the end of this X week process. But there's some really, really interesting things in that, because what some of the students said later on in the focus group was that actually they were confused to start with, but they found that not being told what to do and not knowing where to go was actually really, really beneficial for a learning process. So by the end of it, they said, one student commented that he now feels like he could go into any sport or any at the end when he goes for a job, any sport, and apply the same process that they did in this module and feel absolutely fine, confident in being able to do that, because they didn't have that handheld all the way through the assessment. And I think that is a really interesting thing. And basically, reflections, this confusion plus risk aversion, which is massive, not just for students, not just with the students who want to be told exactly what they want to do and how we're meant to do it, but the lecturers themselves who are now so driven by NSS scores and things like that, how do we allow them to take risks? Plus uncertainty. Well, somehow, if we manage to control these things and manage to develop this into some sort of system where we can allow people to feel okay by doing this, we'll have something freaking awesome. Freaking awesome at the end of it. And I really believe this, because this is now going to be my PhD research, hopefully, is that I'm looking now at this idea of curiosity, how we can manage things like risk, uncertainty, and curiosity using the sort of what we're talking about today, and use it to create something really good and get students to look a little bit more in terms of self-directed learning and looking at deeper learning competencies. Ha! I'm sorry I waffled, and I'm sorry that I've taken you over dinner.
That's fine, I'm sorry that we were all late. Are you all right to share the slides?
Yes, very much so.
Thank you. Because I'm sure some of us would like to pore over them one by one. Those
please do,
packages and in each week.
There's papers and I'm happy to talk to anyone who, I know I've been a bit sort of fluffy over some of the points, but it's all there, and if people want to actually look a little bit more into it, then I'm happy to share whatever we have. So,
hi. Really enjoyed that. some really good points from it. For me, obviously, where you've got 7 weeks of structured learning or objectives effectively, how did you manage the time and the space for those students? Because obviously, if they're going to be analysing samples, etc., you're talking about multiple lab spaces, etc., from the sports science perspective. So how did you go about managing that sort of aspect and where they were doing this and how often, etc.?
I mean, so this was where the professors came really into it, and they have a huge sports department, sports nutrition department. And I think because he has some sway, should we say, that students were allowed basically to put times to go in and out and things like that. I don't know the exact details, unfortunately, of how he managed the actual students going in and around, but I know that a lot of them did a lot of you come in, you get your package, you go away, you do it, and then sort of, if you want to come in and analyse or something like that, then they had time to do that as well. And there was tutorials as well that they could book, so that they had that. They did have guidance, it just wasn't the sort of guidance that they were used to, so.
Yeah, and I think that was my question. So my background is sports psychology, and that's the fundamental thing that I get from my students. Like, you're hounding me all the time about theoretical understanding, how we apply this, but then suddenly you get thrown into an applied setting and they've been expected to do this with a client and expect results. Well, actually, that's really difficult, even for a practitioner who's been doing it for years. So obviously the transfer within that and managing that expectation is just lands fundamentally really well with scheduling.
Yeah, I mean, I think it was the focus group answers of what they said is really, really interesting. There's a lot of stuff in that area, so yeah,
okay.
It was
just on a purely sort of practical level, there's a lot of subterfuge and a fair degree of theatre involved in this whole escapade. How much did you think about this beforehand? I mean, what happens if somebody had busted your game effectively by actually checking on the internet to find out whether this company existed, blah blah blah?
Well, so that was key, and what we did was we didn't actually have anything on the internet, but we had something which was very similar to people that were already there. So the logo for one of the BMI is actually a very similar logo to one of the other British, was it martial arts institute? That's the fake one, but there is a very similar institute. And because I asked the professor about this, I said, oh, do we need to create some fake websites and things like that for them to go off? He said, oh, they seem to think that this is fine. They did try to look for this company, this NitroTrain company, but couldn't find it. And that unnerved them, because they thought, well, where does this come from? There's a nutritional company, and it's not there. But this is reflections for next time, in terms of he wants to recreate this experiment, but bigger, much more risky, more theatrics. And I think next time we're going to create those websites and make it so that if they do go off, it's sort of like alternative reality games. We make sure that all of that information looks like it's real all the way through, so that they could, if they wanted to, maybe order a sample of NitroTrain, then we'd be able to facilitate that on our end.
Sorry, I have another question. Yeah. Obviously, this was done with initially the students not knowing that it was a fake company, etc. So what were the repercussions once they actually knew there was no potential job placement or anything else like that at the end of this?
See, that's interesting, because they never mentioned that. None of the, not that I know of. Now, I need to talk to the professor again about this, but he never told me that they were disappointed or that they were upset. They realised that once it was over, that actually it was a really, from what he said, that they found it, because it was so real, that in itself was a really great learning experience. And I don't know, because I know that if I was a student and I had been tricked this way, I'd probably feel a bit upset.
Yeah, when I was reading some of the bits around that, it's like, well, okay, I like it and need it, because you won't get the engagement in that material as well as you would if you just told them it's all in the assessment, etc. But it was where that boundary is of telling them but not telling them directly that it's all a bit of a rose.
I guess this is the sort of, again, it comes back to the risk. And do we, as educators, just outright trick our students in the most unethical way possible and just get them to really say, right, no, you're doing this as if this was a real thing. But the thing is, you can't say that to them and then take it seriously. So it's like, is it okay to trick them and say, we're doing something which is serious now, and get the best out of them and say, ah, now reflect on your process. Think about how much, you know, you come away with. You know, it's a really, I mean, and that's also going to be part of the research, is that, you know, what is ethical in this, you know, space, and what can you do with your students?
If you're going bigger and better, you're going to consider that more. I mean, believe me, I'm with you, just go for it. But
yeah.
Some other guy in the university is going to be sitting there and saying, whoa, 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 whoa.
Well, I mean, my colleague did an alternate reality game at Salford, and it was the Roofie fanzine one, which is quite a big thing. But basically, she had a whole thing where she didn't tell anyone about it. Almost got fired, because it walked that fine line. But the learning outcomes at the end was so amazing, and the students, when they got to the end, were unbelievably impressed. And they basically, at the end, was a reveal where they were digital media students, and they had videos on screens in the big BBC screen in the middle of Manchester, and that was their end, and they saw their videos up there. And when that kind of kicked in, it's like, this is amazing. But there is the potential for things to go wrong, and that's the thing. It's like, we want to do these really interesting things in HE. How do we convince the lecturers it's safe to do this? How do we manage that with the students?